I'm excited to be here. How about you? All right. That wasn't super excited. I'm going to try it again. I'm excited to be here. How about you? That's more like it. So I was reading an article this week about the jam-packed schedules, crazy lives that Americans have, and it said some recent demographic surveys of workers around the country indicate that across the board, Americans are working longer days, taking less vacations, and retiring at a later age than they did less than two decades ago in the 1990s, which is crazy to think about because in the 1990s, some people did some surveys, and what they found that was that in the 90s, people were working an average of one more month every year than they were two decades earlier in the 1970s. Like, a separate poll that I read this week said that one-third of the American workforce will not use their full allotment of vacation over the course of the next year. We are busy. We live in an incredibly busy society, and those numbers only reflect the work part of our society. They don't even get into the time that we spend on life and eating and sleeping and families and kids and extracurricular activities and hobbies and sports and, most importantly, Netflix and Facebook. There's a lot of hours wrapped up in that right there. There's a lot of hours wrapped up in that. Our schedules are pretty harried. For most of us, we go from one thing to the next thing to the next thing to the next thing to the next thing. We are busy. And some of us kind of like being busy, if we're honest, because our culture pats us on the back for it. Like, we live in a world that tells us that's a good thing. Like, if you're running to your breaking point, if your schedule is so jam-packed that you are stressed, our culture pats you on the back and says, yeah, you're doing it right. That's the American dream, man. Woo! And there are some of us who want to believe that it is, and there are some of us who are stressed out, and there are some of us who use our perpetual overcommitment as a status symbol, right? The phrase, I'm so busy, becomes kind of a humble brag. We do. We get to the point where we're like, oh yeah, I'm so busy. I just wish I had more time for me. I wish I was better at taking time off, but I'm so selfless, such a worker. Someday I'll get there, but I'm just so busy. Right? We do it. Don't lie. We've all been there. Sometimes it's a status symbol for us. We live in a society that glorifies being busy and doing thing after thing after thing after thing. And some of us are at this point where we realize that the pace of our lives, just the sheer G-force of the speed at which life moves in America in 2016 creates stress for us. It creates frustration for us. And the sad reality is that even though so many of us are frustrated, even though so many of us are stressed out, even though so many of us are feeling the weight of the G-force of the speed and the pace of life in 2016, we just keep on going. And we keep on going because of fear. Okay? And most of us haven't looked at our schedules and looked at our lives through that lens before. We haven't ever thought about it that way. We kind of, you know, get to the point where we say, well, yeah, I'm busy. I'm so busy. We're so busy. But when you say I'm busy, or when we say I'm busy, what we are not saying is I'm spending every minute of the day doing something. Okay, that's maybe literally what the phrase I'm so busy means, but check it out. Every human being on this planet is spending every minute of every day of their entire lives doing something. That's not what the phrase I'm busy or I'm so busy means. In America, when we say I'm busy or I'm so busy, what it means is the way that I'm spending my minutes is draining me. We say, oh man, I feel like I am so busy right now. What we're saying is the way that I'm using the time that I have is not quite getting me to the place that I hoped it would get me to. The way that I'm using the time that I have is not quite filling me up the way that I hoped that time would fill me up. And so often, instead of taking a look at our lives and stopping to ask why, okay, if it's not filling me up, if it's not getting me to the place where I want to go, if the way that I'm spending my minutes is draining me, instead of stopping to ask why am I spending my minutes this way, we just keep on going. We keep on going because we're afraid. We're worried that if we don't, that if we slow down even a little bit, we'll miss out. Or we're really worried that our kids will miss out if we don't push them, if we don't put them in every possible thing. And the truth is, if someone asks you the question this morning, why is this a part of your schedule? For so many of us, in the midst of the stress and the craziness and the busyness, our answer would start with the words, well, I'm just afraid that. Like, why are you working so much? Well, I'm just afraid that if I don't get it done. Why is your kid in 13 sports? Well, I'm just afraid that if he's not in everyone, he won't find the one that he really is good at, and then he'll never make the NBA. Right? So many of us get to this point where we're letting our culture and our fear push us to live at the limit. Now, let me explain what I mean by live at the limit by an amazing graphic that I made. I was going to draw it out like on a white piece of paper this morning, and then I remembered that I am sick at using Microsoft Paint. So check it out. That's you, okay? Notice the gender ambiguous hair. I wanted everyone in the room to feel like, okay, that could be me. That person is you, and you have a limit. And some of you are like, I don't have a limit. I'm like the Energizer Bunny. I don't. Not true. We all have a limit. Your limit might be higher than someone else's. It's different for everybody. Some of you in here might not be impeded and hindered by some of the things that others of us in this room are hindered and impeded by that cause us to have lower limits. Some of us are hindered and impeded by sickness that causes our limit to be lower. Some of us in this room are hindered and impeded by small children who've decided that they passionately hate their beds. It causes our limit to be lower. So your limit might be higher than other people's, but we all have a limit, and we all have a pace that we're doing life at right now. And here's what I want us to understand this morning. The difference between the pace that you're doing life at and the limit of things that you can do before you cannot do any more things, the gap between those two things is your breathing room. The gap between the limit of things that you can possibly do and the pace that your life is running at right now. That's the capacity that you have for rest. Okay, and that gap is incredibly important. If it wasn't incredibly important, I would not have spent an hour making this picture so that you guys could understand and visualize how important it is. It's incredibly important to have this gap. Because check it out, when you start living at your limit, or when you start living beyond your limit, your stress level inevitably goes up. You start to lose control of your schedule and your life. You start to not enjoy what you're doing anymore because you can't. You don't have time to enjoy it. And the quality of every single relationship that you have goes down. So we're in the second week now of this series called Life Apps. We're kind of taking a look at the major pressure points of our lives and asking, what if there was an app for that? Like, what if the creator of the universe has a grid that we could apply or a lens that we could look through? There would be a total game changer for us in these areas. And this morning, what I want us to know is that busyness and the stress and the strain that it puts on every aspect of our lives is a massive problem. It's a massive problem that so many of us in this room suffer from, and it prevents us. It prevents us from living the full and abundant lives that God created us for. And so often, it inhibits us from being people who accurately reflect the love of Jesus to our world, who accurately show who Jesus is to the people around us, to every relationship that we have, whether it's our husband or wife, someone that we're dating, our kids, our friends, our coworkers, or our neighbors. And the Life app that God invented for the problem of overcommitment, crazy schedules, and stress-inducing busyness is called rest. It's rest. It's really simple. And here's what I love about rest, okay? The idea that rest is an important part of the way God created us. The idea that rest is part of what it means to be fully alive, part of what it means to live out the abundant life God created us for, part of what it means to be fully human, isn't just one that's found in like a random verse in the Bible. Like sometimes people tell you, oh yeah, it's in the Bible, and then you got to thumb through and it's in some weird proverb, and like, see, I'm pretty sure that's what that proverb means, okay? Rest is not like that. The idea that we're created for rest, we're created to pause, is woven from the very beginning to the very end of the Bible. Like it's there all the way through over and over and over again. You crack your Bible open to the very beginning, Genesis 1 and 2, these creation poems, and what does it say? This is God created the world. This is God created humankind in his own image. And then what did he do? He sat back and he's like, this is pretty awesome. And he rested. He's hung out for a little bit and enjoyed the beauty of the world that he created. Okay, and if you just read Genesis 1 and 2, if those are the only two things you read, and then someone asks you the question, what does it mean that God created human beings in his image? You'd only have a little bit to go off of. And you say, well, okay, if humans are created in the image of God, God created. So being human must mean that we're creative. We're meant to create and to work and to add something to the world. And God rules. So being created in God's image must mean that we're meant to work to manage this incredible world that he created. And God rested. So maybe being human means that every once in a while we're supposed to take a step back and rest and just enjoy the incredible beauty of the world that God made. Maybe, just maybe, that's a part of what it means to be human. Here's the thing, God's serious about that. He's serious about it. It's not just like a suggestion. It's not just one of those things where God's like, hey, you know, maybe if you got some extra time, check out, try resting, think about it. Because fast forward the story a few hundred years, right? And God takes this nation of Israel and he frees them from 4 centuries of slavery in Egypt. And they're like an open slate at this point. And so what God does, he takes them and he's molding them into his people. And he molds them into this people that he intends to be a light to the world, that reflect his glory to all the nations so that everyone can know him. And you guys, if you read the Old Testament, you know that God gives them a whole bunch of commands, a whole bunch of visions for like what it looks like to be this people, like hundreds and hundreds of commands for their good and for their benefit. But there's some commands that are different, right? There's this one list that's special. It's like God's top 10 list. Like, yeah, okay, here's all the commandments, but here's the top 10. So Moses goes up on a mountain and he gets these 10 commandments and he comes back down to the nation of Israel and he's like, okay, this is God's heartbeat. Like there's all these laws that help us function as a society, but these 10 things are just like, this is the heart of God. This is what it means for us to live out the divine spark inside of us. And what does he say? Don't murder anybody. That's bad. Don't steal. Don't lie. Take a day off. That's God's top 10. Take a day off. At least once a week, take a day off. And God tells us that. Like, God includes take one day off a week alongside don't kill anybody and don't cheat on your wife because God knows that we have this tendency to do so many things that we stop enjoying the things that we're doing. If you have your Bibles with you or your phones this morning, you can open them up to Psalm chapter 90. It's right about dead center. If you don't have a Bible, don't worry. The words are going to be on the screen. If you don't own a Bible, we have some at the Next Steps table. Please take one with you. For those of you who are sick of hearing me say that every week, get fired up. We've had so many Bibles taken from the Next Steps table in the last 6 months. We had to order a bunch of from Amazon last week. Okay, so we have new ones now. They're pink, they're blue, they're brown, whatever floats your boat. And you don't even have to believe it to start reading it, okay? If you don't own a Bible, I'm serious. Go pick one up, start reading it. If you had to believe things were true before you could read them, the internet wouldn't exist, okay? It wouldn't. So grab a Bible, grab whatever color one you want, start reading it, and what you'll find, even if you don't believe that it's true yet, is that the Bible has some game-changing wisdom for us. And this morning, we're going to look at like a game-changing piece of wisdom in Psalm 90. And Psalm 90 is a psalm about life and about time and just about how short it really is. And the idea that Psalm 90 throws out for us is one that could change our time. And if we change our time, we change our lives, because our lives are ultimately the summation of the seconds we've been given on this planet. And changing our lives and changing our time the way Psalm 90 suggests that we should do it kills the stress of busyness, because it creates a focus on doing things that are significant and it creates space in our lives for rest. Because Psalm 90 is a psalm written by Moses, which seems weird to us because we don't really think of Moses as a guy who wrote a lot of psalms. We think David wrote a lot of psalms. But if you read the first 5 books of the Old Testament, which Moses wrote, you see he wrote a lot of poetic prayers to God. And one of them is found in Psalm 90. And Moses has something to say about the way that we use our time. And if you're like me, okay, I'm skeptical sometimes. If you're like me, you hear that and you think, okay, fair enough. It's in the Bible. I believe the Bible's true. But what does an old shepherd who lived thousands and thousands and thousands of years ago have to say that's relevant to the way that I use time in America in 2016? Like, some of you have high-pressure jobs. Some of you are stay-at-home moms. That's a high-pressure job. Like, you're like, how does this guy who lived in a totally different culture thousands of years ago, what does he have to say to us? But I think that we have a good reason to listen to what Moses has to say about time for a few reasons. One, Moses lived to be 120. That's old. Okay, and anyone who lives to be 120 has a perspective on like life and time and how fast it goes that most of us don't have. So if you're in the room today and you're 121 or older, you can get up and leave. That's fine. I got nothing else to say to you. You got nothing to learn from Moses. But for those of us who are 119 and younger, maybe, just maybe, we should listen to what the old geezer writes about time, all right? Secondly, I think we can learn from what Moses has to say about time, because he had a really interesting life. And he spent time in some really interesting ways. The first 40 years of Moses' life, he grew up in Pharaoh's court. Pharaoh was the richest guy on the planet at the time. His people thought he was a god. So Moses grew up in this opulent palace for 40 years. And then something happened. The situation escalated quickly. Moses killed a guy. He had to lay low for a while. Okay, so he went to the desert. And he spent the next 40 years of his life as a shepherd. Every morning, Moses woke up. He found his sheep. He took them to the desert. He watched them eat a little bit of grass all day. Then he gathered them. Then he took them back. Then he slept. Then the next morning, he woke up and he found his sheep every day for 40 years. And when Moses was 80 years old, he thought, this is about it. I don't know how much longer I have, but this is how it's going to end. And then one day, he's hanging out with his sheep, and he saw this bush that was on fire, and he's like, oh my goodness. And he went over, and God told him, I got a mission for you. And God totally redirected his life and turned Moses into a world changer. He gave him this huge adventure to go and be God's mouthpiece to Pharaoh and set the Israelites free. And Moses led his people across the Red Sea out to God knows where, because literally only God knew where. God was like, Moses, I'm going to be a cloud. You just follow it. And Moses was like, all right. And he went out in the desert. God led him around, and then he was the leader of this nation. And then they got to the promised land, and they rebelled against God, and God was like, all right, Moses, it's going to be a consequence. I know you're spending your life in like 40-year chunks, but for the next 40 years, you need to zigzag across the desert with these angry people until they all die. Okay, so Moses spent the next 40 years leading this grumpy group of people in circles in the desert, eating the same meal, manna, which means what is it, every single day, for 40 years, and then he got to the precipice of the promised land, and God was like, you don't get to go in. Moses has some things to say to us about life, some things to say to us about time. He's got quite a life story, all right? So Psalm 90, Moses kind of lays out this idea, right, about time and about how short and fleeting it is, this idea that God is eternal, and that God is in control of our lives and our world, and his wrath and his justice mean that there's a penalty for sin, and that penalty is death, and death means that our lives on this planet are going to be short. So what do we do about it? What do we do with this gift of a little bit of time that we've been given? All right, so verse 1, Psalm 90. He writes, Lord, you've been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, you brought forth the whole world. From everlasting to everlasting, you're God. That's such a cool image right there. Moses is painting this picture of the God of the universe and saying, God, your arrows point in both directions. Like from everlasting with no beginning to everlasting with no end. And he's saying somewhere along that continuum, like somewhere along that timeline, the mountains were born and you spoke the earth into being. And then somewhere later along that continuum is my life. So everlasting to everlasting, we're right here, we're right here. And then he continues in verse 3. He says, you turn people back to dust, saying, return to dust, you mortals. It's like one of the coolest lines in the Bible right there. I don't know what God sounds like, but I like to think maybe James Earl Jones on that. Return to dust, you mortals. What a cool line. Okay, so God says, return to dust, you mortals. 1,000 years in your sight are like a day that's just gone by, or a watch in the night, which is like 3 hours, okay? Yet you sweep people away in the sleep of death. They're like the new grass of the morning. In the morning, it springs up new. By evening, it's dry and withered. That's an intense couple of verses, right? It is offensive to our modern consciences that the God of the universe would look at us and say, return to dust, you mortals. But Moses isn't trying to offend us. He's trying to make a point. He's communicating something really clearly here, that God is in control, that God is sovereign, that God has a say about when life begins and when life ends. And Moses is making it clear here that it's not that God smites us at random, but at the very least, God knows exactly how many breaths every single one of us have left on this planet. You know the crazy thing? People who don't consider themselves Christians, people who don't consider themselves spiritual, most of us on this planet have this inborn belief that there is some divine being that has control over when life begins and when life ends. You know how we know that? Because when people get sick and when they get a terminal diagnosis, whether they've been a Christian or whether they haven't, or when someone they love gets it, you know what they do? They pray. They pray. And Moses is saying, good call. Prayer's the right answer. God actually is in control. God knows. He's sovereign over the number of breaths that we take. And then he reminds us, kind of harshly, that no matter what that number is, whether that number for you is a whole lot or whether that number is just a few, for all of us, it's tiny. In the grand continuum of the world, in the grand continuum of eternity to eternity, everlasting to everlasting, we got a fleeting moment to be on this planet. Life is short. We spring up, we wither, and we die really quickly. And for God, it's like a flash. You know, sometimes you look back at the last week of your life and you're like, wow, that flew by. He's saying like a 1,000 years is like that for God. Wow, that flew by. It's like a 3-hour watch in the night. Life is fragile. This is really exciting stuff, isn't it? You guys are pumped up that you came to Revision this morning. Well, hold on to your hats. It gets even better. He continues in verse 7. We are consumed by your anger and terrified by your indignation. You've set our iniquities before you, our secret sins in the light of your presence. All our days pass away under your wrath. We finish our years with a moan. Our days may come to 70 years or 80 if our strength endures. Quick time out. That's a pretty arrogant thing for a 120-year-old guy to write. I mean, it's true, but it's condescending of him. But he's saying, like, what are we going to live, 70 or 80 years max? Yet the best of them are but trouble and sorrow, for they quickly pass and we fly away. If only we knew the power of your anger. Your wrath is as great as the fear that is your due. Moses here, he just dives into the reason that our time is short. It's a consequence for our sin. We live 70 or 80 years if we're lucky, and then we die. And it happens because we turned our backs on God. Because we walked away from this God who loved us, and we sinned. And we said, God, I'm done with you. And because of that, we live in this broken, jacked up world. And it's a broken, jacked up world because we chose it. And our lives are transient because of sin, and they pass like a moan. Which is kind of a weird word to use here. But what it's talking about is not like the sound of a moan, like life. That's not what he's getting at. He's talking about the brevity of the sound. It's this Hebrew word that means moan, thunder, sigh, thought. Saying life passes as quickly as a moan, as quickly as a clap of thunder, as quickly as a thought enters our head and goes. That's how fast life goes by. And then Moses says, your wrath is as great as the fear that is your due. Which is a weird phrase, but this is what he means by that. He said, if we could just see God how he is, we'd give God the reverence that he's due. Specifically, as it relates to our time and our lives. If we could just understand who God is, if we could fully wrap our minds around his holiness, then we would live differently. We would spend our time differently. We'd understand that we have just a few moments on this planet to make an impact and make a difference, and we would spend those few moments in different ways than we spend them now. We'd use the gift of our limited time a little bit differently, in ways that bring more peace and less stress, in ways that bring more significance and fit less into the cultural narrative of busyness that surrounds us. But if we're honest, we don't tend to think that way. I don't tend to think that way. Most of the time, we kind of get to the spot where we believe that the context of our lives is our lives. And Moses zooms us out a little bit and says, no, the context of your life is everlasting to everlasting. And if you could just understand the brevity of it, you would use your time differently. So how? What does that look like to use time the way that Moses is inviting us? That's what he gets to in the next verse. Verse 12 is the apex of Psalm 90. It's Moses' big idea, and it is a revolutionary, life-changing thought that probably most of us have thought, but we just don't tend to use this as the lens through which we see the world. But this is the life app that God has for the busyness and the stress in our lives. This is how we live differently. Verse 12, Moses writes this: teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. All right, teach us because we need to learn. Teach us because this isn't something we get naturally. Teach us to number our days. Teach us to live like our days are numbered. This is what he's saying. Teach us to live as though our time was limited. My nephew turned one earlier this week, and yesterday we were in Ottumwa, Iowa for a 1-year-old birthday party, and he did the whole like cute 20 minutes figuring out how to eat a cupcake thing, and they get really messy, and it's funny, and it was cute, and it was funny. But the whole time I couldn't help but like watch my own kids crowd around him and try and steal his cupcake and keep him away. But like I was watching them with this different lens, because earlier in the week, when I saw my sister post this picture of her in the hospital with him and say, I can't believe a year has gone by, I thought, wow, it's been a fast year. Like the last year of my life have just flown by. I blinked and it was gone. And I thought about how quickly my kids are growing up. And I stood there watching them. I realized, like, I have a 6-year-old son. And not that this is true for everybody, the trajectory this kid is on, the way he's wired, right? If I don't screw anything up, and that's a distinct possibility, right? But if I don't screw anything up, when he's 18, he's gone. And that doesn't mean I'm never going to see him again. And doesn't mean 4 years after that he's not going to move back in with me and live in my basement for a while. But what it means is, like, when this kid is 18, unless I mess him up, he's leaving. And I realize, sitting there watching a kid smash a cupcake in his face, over a third of the time that I have with my son as a kid, it's gone. It's gone, and I can never get it back. Time is a finite resource. And we don't always see it that way. Which is stupid, because we know that it is. It's weird that we don't see it that way, because we know that time is limited, but we don't live like it. We live like time's going to go on and on forever. And we don't do this in any other area of our lives. We know that money is limited, and so we limit our money. And there are seasons of our lives where maybe all of us have known that our time was limited. Like, if you've ever been married, you knew how many days were left. Oh, the women did. The guys didn't know. They just showed up and put on a suit when they got told. But, like, women, you knew how many days were left, and you knew what had to be accomplished in those days in order to get to the point that you wanted to get to. And yet, even though we do it with money, even though we do it with weddings, for most of our lives, we live as though life is going to go on forever. We don't stop and think. We don't number our days. We don't limit our time. We treat it like an endless resource. And Moses says, no, this is a huge mistake. This is a huge mistake. And check it out. What he's trying to say here is really encouraging and not discouraging. You might be feeling right now like, oh my gosh, I'm talking about, like, you're almost done with your kids and life is fast and stressful. Like, you might not be feeling really encouraged yet, but Moses is not trying to beat us down. He's not trying to discourage us. He's trying to fire us up about what life can be. Because he closes verse 12 with this vision. He says, teach us to number our days so that we may gain a heart of wisdom. So, oh God, if we could just understand that our time is limited, then we can live this totally different kind of life that doesn't waste our time anymore on the stuff that isn't important. That doesn't allow ourselves to get stressed out by running the cultural tapes in our heads, but instead, like, gets fired up about using the time that we have to do the stuff that we really want to do. Moses is saying, if we can see time through this lens, through God's eyes, if we can understand that our days are numbered, we're going to gain a heart of wisdom. We'll gain perspective on what really matters, on what should still be a part of our schedule, on what should be more a part of our schedule, and what should we quit, on what doesn't deserve a spot anymore in the little bit of time that we have left on this planet. Because Moses is saying, man, if you do this, life changes. If you start to live like life's going to be over, then you start to live for what matters. You start to live for what's wise, and life changes. But if you don't, if we don't number our days, if we don't understand that it's going to be over, what happens is we continue to fill our lives with things that don't matter. We continue to buy into the cultural narrative and cram our schedules with busyness past our breaking point, past our limit, and the stress and the frustration and the time spent chasing things that don't matter ultimately becomes the legacy of our lives. To quote the great Ferris Bueller, life moves pretty fast. If you don't stop and take a look around once in a while, you might miss it. But that's where some of us are headed. I don't want to say this as a guilty party, as someone who's so much a part of this culture, so much a part of the jamming your schedule to the point of reaching or passing your limit. So many of us are headed to that point where we're missing it. We're missing it. And Moses, the desperate cry of his heart in the psalm is that we wouldn't miss it anymore. But it's easy to miss. I mean, when it comes to our work, there are a lot of us in this room who have traded our peace for prosperity. And we're working and we're working and we're working. We're pouring in all these hours, hoping beyond hope that someday we can get enough prosperity to buy ourselves some peace. And when it comes to our kids, we've traded time with them for achievement. For putting them in these things and pushing them and pushing them and pushing them to achieve and achieve and achieve. And I was thinking this week, okay, if take a day off is right up there with don't cheat on your wife for God, then I need to be really intentional about it. So I was thinking about how I can be more intentional in making sure I take one full day off a week. And then I looked at my kid and I had to run him to swimming lessons. I thought, between church and Awana and swimming lessons and soccer and t-ball, does my kid get a day off every week? Does yours? That was a convicting one for me. Like, are we taking a day off Are we making sure our kids get a day off? Like when we live as though time is limited, we gain this phenomenal perspective about what we want to spend that time on and what we don't anymore. What's worth it? What's worth our time if time is life and life is short? There's this book called Regrets of the Dying. It was written by an Australian nurse named Bronnie Ware. She's a hospice nurse who spent most of her career nursing people who were in the last 2 weeks of their lives. And after years and years of nursing these people and having deathbed conversations with them, she collected their top regrets. She collected the conversations that she had over and over and over again, and she did us a favor because she gave us a picture of what it looks like at the end. I want to share with you guys the top two regrets this morning. I'm going to start with number two because it's one I think most of us would guess is number one. The number two regret is, I wish I hadn't worked so hard. Bronnie Ware wrote that 100% of the men that she sat with as they were dying voiced this regret to her. And a number of women did too, but she was nursing an older generation. A lot of them had never worked outside the home, but she said the number one thing that men said, every single one of them said, I wish I hadn't worked so hard. And they sat there as they were dying, and they looked at this nurse and told her, I spent so much time building a career when I could have spent time with my kids, and I can never get that back. I spent so much time trying to work and trying to achieve and trying to succeed, and I missed out on spending time with my wife. And she said person after person after person expressed regret that their spouse had wanted to take a trip with them, and they never were able to find that trip and take that time and do that thing that they'd always dreamed about doing. And the number one regret, the number one regret, the most heard one across culture and gender and everybody else that she sat with was this: I wish I'd had the courage to live a life true to myself, not the life that others expected. I wish I had the courage to throw off the cultural narrative and pursue the dreams that God had put on my heart. I wish I'd had the courage to be it. She said a lot of people talked about their parents in this, which was like a really sobering moment for me because I realized, like, if you're too successful as a parent, then your kids whine that it's too much pressure and they don't want to be like you. If you're a failure as a parent, then you bombed out and they don't want to be like you. If you're in the middle, then you're so boring and they don't want to be like you. Like, if you're a parent, you lose every which way. There's no winning as a parent. Your kids just don't want to be like you. But that's an aside that I was thinking about. But like, seriously, so many people sat there and they talked on their deathbeds to this nurse about the dreams that they had that they never accomplished. And she estimated that most people don't even accomplish a fraction of the dreams that they wish they did in their lives. So my question for us this morning is like this: what are the dreams that God has put inside of you that you don't want to die not having realized? What are the visions God has laid on your heart that you want to make sure you see before you breathe your last breath on this planet? And what are the things in your schedule that are keeping you too busy, so busy, that those dreams and those visions are going to shrivel up and die inside of you, and you sit on your deathbed never having seen them? I mean, these are the two biggest regrets dying people have. From Bronnie Ware, you're welcome, I'm welcome, we're all welcome. She just fast-forwarded us to the end and showed us what it looks like there. And so the question for us is, what are we going to do about it now? Moses is offering us a different vision here. He's offering us a different end. An end to a life that was lived as though time was limited, so we limited our time. One where we saw things from an eternal perspective and we lived out the fullness of what it means to be a human being on this planet created in the image of God. One where we decided we were going to get rid of busyness and stop living at the edge of our limits in favor of living for what is important, what matters most, in favor of creating capacity for rest. Because that's part of what it means to live the lives that God created us for. It's part of what it means to be fully alive. I know at first glance that sounds counterintuitive. That idea that, like, living as though our time was limited creates space for rest. Numbering our days creates space to step back and enjoy the world. It seems like it would be the opposite way, right? It seems like if we're living as though time were limited, we should pack our schedules even more. We should run an even greater pace. But that's not the vision Moses is painting here. He gives us this incredible, freeing picture at the close of the psalm. The very last verse, verse 17, he says this. I love it. He says, may the favor of the Lord our God rest on us. Establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. What he's saying is, hey, if we live like this, if we can get this picture of life as it really is, if we can get this idea that God created us to maximize the time that we have on this planet for Him and for impact and for the stuff that really matters, if we can stop chasing all the stuff that our culture tells us to chase, if we can get this, then we can have incredible peace in that because we know God is in charge. Establish the work of our hands. God's in charge of your success, not you, not your hard work. God is sovereign, and He's in control, and He loves you, and He created you to be like Him by stepping back and taking a rest and loving the world He created, because when you do that, everything about who you are and everything about every relationship that you have is better. I know this is countercultural stuff. It is. Like thinking about time as limited, being intentional about the way we spend our schedules instead of just trying to pack them with every possible thing we can pack them with. Thinking about rest as a wise, meaningful, necessary, critical part of living out a life of purpose and meaning in the world that flies in the face of our cultural narrative that tells us, what if you miss out? What if you don't make it? What if? But what Moses is telling us, what God's inviting us into this morning, and this message has been powerful and important for me to think through and for me to preach. I'm right there with you, but I think what God is inviting every single one of us to think through this morning is that if we can see life through His eyes, we can not only find peace and rest as an answer to the busyness of our lives, but we can also begin to use the time we have for the things that really matter. We can live like we were dying, to steal a phrase from Tim McGraw. And that doesn't, living like we're dying doesn't mean that you have to go skydiving, Rocky Mountain climbing, or ride 3.7 seconds on a bull named Fu Manchu. If you don't know what I'm talking about, God bless you. I don't like country music either. But like living like we're dying, okay? Living like we're dying means for all of us, there are things in our world we need to add to our schedules that we haven't been doing that we better start doing so we can see the visions and the dreams we have come to reality. There are things in our schedules that we got to quit. And maybe those things have names, like people's names. There are things in our schedules we got to quit. There are things in our schedules we need more of and things in our schedules we need less of. You all got a card when you walked in. Plus, minus, more, and less. Okay? Seeing through God's lens creates the capacity in our lives for rest and the capacity to maximize the time that we have on this planet to make a difference and do the things that are really important. So here's what I want you to do this week. I want you to take that card, and if you have someone that you're close to, a roommate, a friend, husband, wife, boyfriend, girlfriend, whatever it is, parent, take it home and talk it over with them. I added one plus for you, okay? Because I doubt that many of you are awesome at that one. I added one. Add rest. Take a day off once per week. Add that. What are the things? I want you to just pray it over, talk it over. And if you're in house groups, we're going to ask you this week. Thursday people, you got a couple more days than the Monday people. Monday people, you better do it quick because I'm going to ask you tomorrow night. But talk it over. Ask this question. What are the things? If I want to maximize my life, if I'm going to live like I was dying, if I'm going to live with eternity in mind and understand that the bounds of my life are not my life, but it's eternity and it's short and I got a limited number of breaths left on this planet, what do I need to add? What do I need to get rid of? What do I need to do more of? And what do I need to do less of so that I can have capacity for rest, capacity to sit back and enjoy the beauty of the world God made, so that I can be refreshed to go out and make a difference in it. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for being a good, good Father who creates us in your image for rest. Lord, I know it's hard. It's hard in this world we're living in. It's hard in this society to take time out. It's hard to push aside those cultural tapes in our heads that we might miss out. What if? I'm afraid that, I'm worried that. God, I pray that you just help us to do that. To do it here and now in ways that free us up. That free us up from the prisons of trying to live out the expectations that other people had for us. That free us up from the prisons of feeling stressed beyond our breaking point because of the incredible pace of life in America in 2016. Free us up to live the lives that you created us for. God, let us be people who live like we're dying and spend the moments that we have, this incredible gift of life that you've given us, on the stuff that really matters. prayed in Jesus' name.